We're talking about ending the wars in Syria and Afghanistan, a task that on its own has turned into its own quagmire. Last time we checked in on the story, we were in Afghanistan negotiating peace with the Taliban, and in Syria with Trump saying we were about to leave. To which Bolton and Pompeo clapped back, nah, in a very public way, leading to Trump saying, let me check my business card really quickly. Oh, it says here that I'm the commander-in-chief, not you. So yeah, we're leaving. Now we're here today, because if you want to get something done quickly, you know who you want to get involved, right? Congress.
In a blow to U.S. President Donald Trump, the Senate has passed a non-binding amendment opposing plans to withdraw troops from Syria and Afghanistan.
Before we talk about what this means, we need to talk about what this is. Because the amendment specifically said it's not to be construed as a declaration of war or as an authorization for the use of military force. Yeah, they're not authorizing military force in the same way your mother didn't make you go to that last family dinner. Despite the fact that it might be your grandfather's last one, and I'm sure he'd really like to see you there. Now, I know some of you are saying, hey, Mitch McConnell, there are probably easier ways to advise the president than passing an amendment to legislation. I mean, you're big enough to get a guest spot on Fox News. So now the broader question of why this matters.
My amendment would acknowledge the plain fact that Al-Qaeda, ISIS, and their affiliates in Syria and Afghanistan continue to pose a serious threat to us here at home.
Yeah, this amendment was brought to you by Mr. Let's Not Bring to Chambers any government reopening legislation the president wouldn't vote for, McConnell. Turns out, when it comes to ending the end of several wars, this legislator isn't scared to come out of his shell. Not only did he and fellow Republicans take a rare stand and take the bold step of essentially sending a strongly worded reply all email, but this amendment received strong bipartisan support in a 72-24 vote. And in a Senate that's 45 Democrats and 53 Republicans, well, that's just a surprising number of people who want to keep this war party going. Also, I feel like I have to mention the elephant in the room.
Earlier this week, President Trump criticized the U.S. intelligence community after the heads of the CIA, FBI, and others publicly contradicted him on threats posed by ISIS, North Korea, and more.
And, Mitch, why are we introducing this legislation again?
The plain fact that Al-Qaeda, ISIS, and their affiliates in Syria and Afghanistan continue to pose a serious threat.
Right on. So it seems like someone agrees with intelligence. Which, yeah, I wish there was a less condescending way of saying that, but in this case, intelligence is on his side. On the other side, we have the House of Representatives, where New Jersey Democrat Tom Malinowski and Wisconsin Republican Mike Gallagher have recently presented bills that would ban Trump from withdrawing troops from South Korea and Syria. Notably absent from that list is Afghanistan. But that kind of makes sense, because the key thing we bring to the negotiating table over there is, well, eventually we'll leave. All of this is wild, considering the last time Congress dragged the president into continuing a conflict, the United States won the Philippines and Cuba from Spain. So yeah, it was a while ago. Most of my past research on the subject has been on how Congress can end wars, but how can Congress continue them? Well, you could pass a non-binding resolution like McConnell did, saying, let's talk this out more. Hey, where are you going? Please, turn the television off. There are some other interesting options, though. For example, what is this House proposal to ban removal of forces? I mean, it's hard to tell the commander-in-chief, but yeah, bad command. The strategy here is along the same lines of,
I gave a speech making it clear that I'll veto a bill that restricts our commanders on the ground in Iraq, a bill that doesn't fund our troops, a bill that's got too much spending on it.
Back to May 7th, 2007, a simpler time when the Iraq War was somehow a less popular war than that poke war that you started with half of the kids at your high school. And all Americans could come together and agree that intelligence had in fact lied to us about WMDs to get us into that war, like this.
Baghdad has failed to disarm its weapons of mass destruction, willfully attempting to evade and deceive the international community. Our particular concern is that Saddam Hussein may supply terrorists with biological, chemical, or radiological material.
Oh no! Well, let's just pretend like we didn't just see that, and if the report says there's anthrax in Trump Tower, give it a once-over. And this time, the slim majority of Democrats who ran the Senate decided not to fund the military unless the commander-in-chief committed to pulling troops out of Iraq. Because Congress controls the funding, they could leave American troops high and dry. Now, Bush ended up vetoing the spending bill because you can't go against the most popular bumper sticker in America and expect to win. A month later, both sides made a compromise to fund the troops in exchange for benchmarks that local Iraqi governments had to keep in order to get non-military aid money. With compromises like those, it's kinda hard to imagine why we're still in Iraq. So instead of putting together a withdrawal timeline, we could set up a system where we can cut funding to their local government. So how does that story apply to the bills we're talking about today in the House? Well, the bills would prohibit the use of military funds to reduce the number of active duty troops serving in Syria and South Korea. Basically just...
This afternoon, at the last minute, Mr. Trump rescinded approval for a U.S. military plane to fly Pelosi and a congressional delegation to Afghanistan.
On steroids. Sure, you can withdraw all of these troops, but they better start getting on Travelocity now to book seats on the next Syrian air flight out of Aleppo, which is leaving as soon as we build an airport. Now, it's not like this legislation would trap US forces in Syria and Korea forever. If it did, I'm sure we'd be hearing any discussion about it. Instead, if this passes, a troop withdrawal would require the thumbs up from our Defense Secretary, our Secretary of State, and our Director of National Intelligence to get funding. You know, the same people who...
The president calling the intelligence officials he hired passive and naive, suggesting in a tweet today they go back to school.
Now you might be saying, well, if those bills pass, they'll just get vetoed by the president. But the bipartisan support backing these bills could actually give Congress a veto-proof majority. So that's the latest news in the Middle East's peace talks. Congress is throwing their hat into the ring by trying to keep the wars going without the president's support. I mean, as if the Middle East peace process couldn't get any harder. Now, between meetings with the Taliban, this administration's gonna have to be negotiating with McConnell and Congress. All of this is just to add another level to the stale tiramisu that is the Middle East peace process. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the right of my head. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.